now reconvened discussions on the fiscal year 2017 budget proposal from the Bureau of Budget and Management Research. I want to preface this budget hearing, as I have with all other budget hearings, with the fact that the government of Guam has experienced or has a FY 2015 cumulative general fund deficit of about $120 million. Now more than ever, we all have to understand that increasing expenditures against potential declining or flat revenue levels may not be realistic. We may all have to come to that realization either now or at some time in the near future. With that, Mr. Calvo, you are recognized. I believe you received a letter about what
for the agenda today?
Yes.
Yes, Vice Speaker. Yes. Thank you, sir. I'd like to introduce myself and the staff that's with me here today for this hearing. My name is Joey Calvo, BBMR Director.
BBMR Supervisor.
Bill Taitingfong, BMA Supervisor.
Francis Cruz, ASO.
Jason Baza, Analyst.
Matt Canato, Analyst.
I would like to thank the officials from BBMR for joining us today to continue discussions relative to the Governor's Fiscal Year 2017 Executive Budget Request that was transmitted to the Guam Legislature on February the 1st, 2016. This morning, we will be discussing BBMR's FY 2017 budget request, as well as the current general fund revenue tracking in BBMR's June 2016 consolidated revenue and expenditure report, which utilizes 9 months of actual revenue collections and 3 months of revenue tracking. We need to know where we are today in order to get a sense of where we may be tomorrow. In the afternoon portion of this hearing, we will be discussing the Governor's FY 2016 General Fund and Special Revenue Fund revenue projections, with the Bureau's providing detailed justifications, reasoning, and rationale for the nearly 11% increase in general fund revenues above the 2016 adopted revenues. Because it has been over 5 months since we've had our initial budget hearings with BBMR on February the 25th of 2016 regarding these revenues, and we have new data, it is important to discuss these new developments. With that, Mr. Director, I would like to ask you to proceed with your presentation.
Thank you, Vice Speaker. Buenas and half a day, Vice Speaker BJ Cruz, Committee on Appropriations and Adjudication. Thank you for the opportunity to present the Bureau of Budget and Management Research's Fiscal Year 2017 Budget Request. BBMR is seeking a FY 2017 appropriation level of $1,708,781, which is $178,985, or 11.6%, more than the FY 2016 authorized level of $1,529,796. Of this request, the sum of $1,377,217 is requested from the general fund, and the remaining balance of $331,564 is requested from the indirect cost fund. The Bureau's FY 2017 budget request, as compared to its FY 2016 authorized level, reflects increases in personnel services cost of $177,789, or 12%, and in utilities telephone expenses of $1,228, or 9%. The operations request is relatively status quo, but does reflect a decrease of $32. A total personnel services cost of $1,653,52,234 is being requested to fund the salaries and benefits of 23 employees, which is $177,789, or 12% more than the amount authorized in FY 2016. The request includes funding for 4 vacant positions, which were vacated in 2016 by employees through retirement or promotions, to fill four other positions which were vacated in 2015, either by transfers or retirements. At the time of our submission of the BBMR FY 2017 budget request in March 2016, the Bureau had 19 staff members and four vacancies. These vacancies were the result of two senior employees retiring and the internal promotion of two other employees, a BMA supervisor and the other a BMA 2 position. These are the vacancies that we speak to replace, that we seek to replace through promotions of existing staff and the recruiting of new employees to replace those that have been promoted. The Bureau is currently undergoing the recruitment process, and it is at the interview stage presently. In an effort to replace all of these four vacancies to maintain its current manpower level at 23 positions. A total of $40,687 is being requested to fund the Bureau's operating expenses, which are $32 less than the authorized level of $40,709 in FY 2016. Of the amount requested, $12,431 will cover costs for contractual services such as periodical subscriptions, active directory subscription, and lease maintenance of copiers. $28,256 will provide for supplies and materials such as office and copier supplies, printer cartridges, and storage boxes. Although no funding is being requested for drug testing, should we do the recruitment process, this requirement will be addressed via an internal budget transfer when the need arises. Telephone expenses are being requested in the amount of $14,860, or 9% more than the FY 2016 authorized level. The increased telephone funding is to cover the additional costs needed for additional telephone lines and long distance charges. In summary, the Bureau's major increase is in personnel service for the hiring of personnel to replace and fill positions vacated through retirements. The Bureau's prior staffing level was at a high of 32 full-time employees at the start of FY 2000. It is imperative that the Bureau maintain the manpower level requested due to the increase in workload demands and mandated reporting requirements on current staff caused by the loss of employees due to the attrition during the current and past fiscal years. Also, there's a slight decrease in operations and a slight increase in utilities for telephone expenses. Me and my staff are open to any questions from the committee regarding the Bureau's FY 2017 budget request as presented. Jesus Masi.
You're admittedly you're a small department, but the amount that you're requesting is an 11% increase.
That's focused on personnel, Vice Speaker. We're just trying to increase our capacity. We've lost people in the past, and we want to replace them, and then we just want to add a few more. We used to have 32 employees back in the early 2000s. And we had them for some time before we started to contract, basically, as employees leave the Bureau, due to retirement, due to maybe being transferred or seeking other employment. So we continued to contract for many years, and we're just trying now to just get some of it back. That's basically the idea in our presentation.
And with the current financial condition the government is in, and no one knows it better than your department, is it responsible?
I think it's a good investment. Two, three positions or four positions to provide assistance in our financial involvement in the government would be a good investment. We do have a lot of projects. We do a lot of execution of this executive budget document. So I think it's a worthwhile investment. We need these people to also contribute to the workings and the contributions that the Bureau has made and would continue to make?
Has BBMR received a GG1 request from Bureau of Statistics and Plans to replace their statisticians that they have in that department?
I think we have cleared a couple. We may not be up to par with clearing maybe everything, but we have cleared. We have cleared. And correct me if I'm wrong. Do you know what position number that might be?
I don't have the position number, but I know that that no offense, but the business community outside really depends on the economic reports that are done by Bureau of Statistics Plan. And I do know that they have had a couple of retirements.
Yes.
There's
they're very similar with us.
There's been a huge exodus out of that department. And if I was given a choice between trying to replace people, I'd replace them before I'd replace anybody in your office, because at least I'd be able to use their data. So I'm just wondering whether or not you guys have held up their request for...
No, I don't think we've held up the request for statisticians. I will follow up with that. I understand your point about the data. But don't choose. Please include us in that as well. Thank you.
Is BBMR subject to the 15% reserve?
Yes. We have a report that will be, I think we are submitting today. So yes, we are also, based on our policy, mandated to do the 15%. We're included.
According to your actual labor cost on the AS-400, you appear to be tracking an average payroll with salaries and benefits of about $51,000 per pay period over the last 5 pay periods. If we annualize that amount, BBMR expects to expend $1,326,000 in salaries and benefits of about $150,000 less than what you are allocated in the current FY16 budget. Can BBMR sustain its operations with the 2016 level of 14.75?
Yes, sir, we can. We had we lost two people to retirement, and we may be losing. We had one in military leave, so we were able to generate adequate lapses, so to speak, to fund our operations. So yes, we are able to adequately fund our operations with the level.
So we need to go up to the 1.7?
Well, the 1.7 is for fiscal year 17. So during the transition or the interim period and for the next couple months, we are, and we've already began the process, we're going to be bringing in staff to fill those that have left, that have vacated their positions. So we're going to fill those during the next month or so. And then in 17, the increase that we're asking of like 177,000 would be to bring about 4 more.
When were those retirements?
When were?
Yeah, when?
The end of the beginning of the fiscal year, we had October, then we had one in December, then we might be having one soon. And then we had, we lost 3. We'll be losing 3. We've lost 2, we'll be losing another in about a week. Go ahead, correct me, please.
We had one retiree in October, one retiree in December, and we just lost another analyst 4 this month in July, and an analyst 2 who took a transfer.
And when did you submit the GG1 for the one that retired in October?
We were beginning the recruitment process. Maybe the talk of bringing them on happened even at the latter part of December, and then follow that up with, you know, cutting the request to fill. So we have going through the process now. Gigi wants to fill some of our positions, and we've even interviewed a few the last couple of weeks.
In as much as which positions have you started to interview? The vacancy from October and December?
Well, for those positions were high level positions, but we started the recruitment process for analyst ones and analyst twos, lower level. The ones we lost to retirement, obviously they you know, being that their service is 30 years old, plus, the funds for that for those positions were relatively high, but we're coming in recruiting at the lower level at this particular point in time.
And would you be able to fund with two senior members retiring, a third member without asking for any additional funds? If you're going to only be doing one and twos?
We have internal promotions also that we wanted to do, and I think we have a three that we're trying to,
and
a four that we're trying to recruit also. So once all of those guys settle in, then we'll be at the staffing level that we want it to be before moving into FY17, when we are going to pick up additional per our request of $178,000 more.
So you obviously haven't suffered the Department of Administration slowdown in clearing your GG ones.
No, we're going through the process. It takes some time. It takes maybe a couple months. We're in that same timeline. So as far as suffering, well, you know, that's the process, and we're just going through it, patiently waiting for things to happen.
She claims her turnaround time is 38 days. That she takes in a GG1 and turns it out within 38 days. Are you experiencing a longer period than that?
Well, I'm just saying that we are probably in the same pool, same timeline as others. So if she said 38, then I cannot dispute that, but I'm just saying it does take time.
And when do you anticipate picking these people up? And you're going to be staying within the current 1.5 right now?
Within the 2016 level, yes.
So you're not?
We're not going to be asking for more money in 2016. We're going to fill those positions moving forward.
And I'm asking, can you survive on that so that we can balance this budget, or do you really need to add additional people?
We want to add people, Vice Speaker, because again, Mac, in the 2000s for several years, we had 32.
There was a time when this legislature had so much money, the government had so much money. In this legislature, we each had $1 million budget.
All I'm asking is
those were the days. Those are not the days today.
We continue to contract over the years, and we're just trying to get four more back. That's the request that we're putting forward. It's a far cry from 32, but we're still trying to build up our capacity.
I'll allow my colleagues to ask questions on that.
Good morning,
Senator. How are you? Senators, good morning.
Yes, thank you. You know, you had just mentioned, and this is perhaps related to the positions you're asking, you had mentioned that you have projects that you're working on. Can you just, that would need the additional positions? So can you elaborate a little bit more on that, or anyone?
Well, generally, just in meeting our workload, you know, what we have to do on a regular basis is enough really to require additional staffing. You know, the managing of the budgets, projections, other special projects like that. So it's not really just only special projects, but it's more in general, you know, the workload that we have to produce. We just need some help in that regard.
So, you know, for me, I understand, right? But we're actually trying to explain this to the general public, because if you're asking for additional funding for additional positions, and especially with the tight, I'm just trying to give you an opportunity right now, or any of your team members, to explain what some of those special needs are that warrants the number of positions that you are requesting.
Okay.
I clearly know, as somebody who had worked with all of you at one time or another, about the importance of BBMR, but this is now just for our public.
With respect to the hiring, we've been at a level of 19 people for quite some time. And the reason why we are able to do the work we're doing now is because a lot of the senior analysts were there. Now, in the last 3 years, we lost two or three senior analysts. We're talking about levels fours and threes. So a lot of the work has been carried on by the people that are left, myself and other supervisors that double up the work. We're trying to rebuild. We've been pulling back on the line. We know BBMR is the gatekeeper. So we really have held back on a lot of the hiring. And in fact, when we lost the two seniors the first quarter of this fiscal year, we did put in a request for recruitments. But we really didn't start doing the interviews until just 2 weeks ago or a week ago. We were trying to hold the line as far as we can, but like anyone else, we're also feeling the effects of multicasting, and we're juggling our time around. So what we're trying to do is just rebuild. If you look at the history, yes, we were at one time at 30, but when you compare the fiscal budgets as far back as 2005, 2006, they really contracted to the point where we're doing a lot of the work like anyone else. And we know that, and we accept it. But we really need to rebuild, because a lot of our senior people are gone. And the fact is that even though we have these people, the new recruits, they still have to be trained. To train someone at entry level is like 6 months to a year, and then we have to work closely with them in addition to what we're doing now. So what we're asking is just to rebuild. We're willing to work with the staff so that we can get to the park. I myself will probably be retiring in another 2 years. Bill, us also. So a lot of the number of people that are here now are probably going to be gone in 2 years, within 1 or 2 years, maybe three. So we need the staff. We need to get them promoted so that they can pick up part of our workload, do the tasks we're doing, and we need to train the new ones that are coming in. So what we're seeking is getting up to par, at least up to 24, 23 members. Now, we have not, if you look at our budget, we have kept it at 19. We're just not asking. We asked for it last year, we didn't get it, so we worked within the budget. Now we're asking to see if we can start doing the rebuilding so that the office can continue its mission.
So basically, Mr. Cowell, from my understanding, right, my limited understanding, you know, one of the important functions that you actually do is you review all of the proposed legislation, and it is BBMR that actually provides an analysis of the impact of that legislation and the fiscal notes, right? So when we propose from a legislative point of view, that's what you do. You do that kind of research. That's the kind of analysis that you do. But I also understand that, like, for example, some of the line agencies, all of the line agencies, when they send in a requisition to travel, isn't it that you have to clear it within the budget? I'm just trying to tease out the complexity of your division.
Yes, you're correct, Senator. We're mandated to provide a fiscal impact via fiscal notes in any proposed legislation that the legislature introduces and passes it on. We do comment on those, and it does require coordination with either the affected agencies or even outside or external parties. We try to bring all those numbers together to present to you. So there's a lot of research that goes into it and time. So that's on the fiscal note aspect. As far as the when you talk about travel, we are under executive order to do review travel requests and to dispose of them, either approve them or disapprove them. It does flow through our office. You just specifically mentioned travel, but we also do contractual contracts and the like. Yeah.
Because I remember you always have to have that certification from BBMR that there's in fact monies that are adequate funding for
right.
whatever, even the RFPs and the the bids or.
We're involved in many of those aspects. Yes.
Okay, so. The other aspect from the department's point of view, again, calling back with DOE, right, a long time ago, and we didn't quite have our set, you also release, you make sure that the releases for the allotments are certified.
We do, we do release allotments. We only want to talk about that, but basically we do release allotments to GDOE.
Okay.
Yes.
But even if you release the GDOE allotments, that doesn't mean DOA has to release the check.
That's a different side of the equation, Vice Speaker. Yes, it has to put into the cash flow
but they have to certify
situation.
You have your job to make
That's
sure
right.
that there's
The appropriation, authorization is there. Yes, we deal with that.
Chairman, if I just on a follow-up question on the employment situation, can I just ask, do you anticipate in fiscal 17 that you'll be losing any more employees to retirement?
It's possible that this guy just dropped the bomb. 2 years, you're going to retire, sir. I wish we had this discussion at our house. And then Bill again. There's another guy. You're going to start talking to me, please. And we do have one, two, three, four.
That could potentially.
These are all possibilities already because they almost came in at the same time. You know, the two that we lost, one in October and December.
Right.
It's almost the same time that they came in. You know, that the others, some of the others came in. So we're going to be potentially losing them. So they're going to be hitting their 30-year mark, which it makes them eligible. I'm hoping that they'll stick around longer. You know, so that they can help me as we. We move this whole thing forward, but yes, we should be losing actually.
Well, and this is kind of a catch-22 type of a question for you, because of course, the reasoning would be that if you do lose, of course, you'd need to replace that. You'd have to move your people up, probably to fill the senior positions, but then you'd hire new people, and so the question in my mind, at least, becomes whether that increase is necessary, even if you do lose your senior manager, because you'll be coming in with new people at a lower salary. And again, and like I said, it's a catch-22 question for you, not that I intended it to be, but it does raise the issue, at least in our minds, especially in these tight fiscal times when we're trying to be as conservative as possible, whether the need is really there. But then again, the other side of that equation, that if they don't leave, there's a potential they don't leave. There's a potential they leave, and there's a potential they don't leave. And if they don't leave, of course, you still have to maintain the status quo and then bring in some new people, like you said. So I just wanted to try to understand what the true equation is. And so when you're talking about, I think, what is about $178,000, $180,000 more, you know, in my mind, it's probably doable. But again, I'll leave that up to the chair to determine once he figures out all the numbers for the agencies.
Yeah, and you're right, Senator, it's a catch-22. But I like that latter presentation of yours, the fact that everybody stays. And we bring on more people as opposed to lose more, because then the challenge there would be to try to fill those plus the four. So, you know, we understand that it is catch 22, but that's how we're saying these guys have been threatening to leave me for a while now, but I think they'll stick around. So it would be the additional four that would be working.
I heard from John, it depends on where you're treating him to lunch today.
And I am going to do that.
Well, thank you.
Treat him well.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm glad we're discussing this because even throughout some of the other discussions with the other agencies, I'm not sure, even when I came in at the serving as the director of BSP, I came in at a time where there was a mass exodus. Everyone starts, and still seeing it happen. And of course, I understand there's at this juncture, there's a lot of folks at that time they're looking at their options of retirement. So I think that succession plans have to be put in place to ensure continuity of these services, especially the critical nature of your department that serves all the line agencies. And I hope that even throughout, because we just saw in one agency, they came and actually were proposing a negative because they lost people. They're proposing a negative in regular salaries, and I didn't understand that when it was I believe it's a critical agency that deals with our IT development and how we grow and advance our government. So I hope that they have some succession plans in place so that they don't come here and propose because they're losing people. They're gonna zero out those vacancies. So I hope there's always that movement and not waiting for people to retire. And I'm glad that we're having this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now let me bring us back to reality. Let's go on to the discussion of the CRER.
I have a couple. Can I make a couple of comments on that? CRE, we're talking about the CRER now, so we're moving to the next.
Yes.
I'm sorry, Vice Speaker. Let me just. I just have to note it to keep on point for the agenda. So we're done with item number one.
Yes.
The BBMR FY 2017 budget request. Okay. So we're moving to item number two. Can I make an overview of the CRER? Is that okay? Thank you.
Yeah, upset me some more. Go ahead.
Thank you. Well, no, we're not trying to upset you, sir, but, there was no intent on our side to do that.
I'm just saying, please don't call it a draft and don't depend on it, because otherwise your department is irrelevant.
A draft? I'll continue with my CRR comments. Buenas and half a day, Vice Speaker and the members of the Committee on Appropriations and Adjudication. Thank you for the opportunity to speak on the CRER for FY 2016. Based on the Consolidated Revenue and Expenditure Report of June 2016, submitted to the legislature about a week ago, the revenue tracking for fiscal year 2016 is at $825,675, which is above the fiscal year 2016 adopted revenues by $654,572, or 8%, or 0.08%. On a monthly basis, the Bureau, in coordination with its fiscal partners, Department of Administration and Department of Revenue and Taxation, will report how much revenue is collected and also anticipate what the numbers may look like at the end of the fiscal year via the CRER. It's important to note that every monthly transmittal of the CRER to the speaker, it reads, enclosed is a consolidated revenue expenditure report for the period ending, and we're talking at this time June 30th, 2016. There are several statutes requiring monthly reports of revenues in addition to a report requiring both revenue and expenditure comparisons. In an effort to mitigate misunderstanding of the different amounts being reported, it was necessary to submit a consolidated report which contains all the comparative information pursuant to each of the statutory reporting requirements. In this format, it is evident that there are varying numbers due to the different basis of comparison. It should be noted that the amounts reflected in this report are subject to internal audit and analysis and therefore are subject to change, which is the nature of these interim reports. However, it is subject to meet compliance with each reporting mandate. It is important to note that the Department of Administration, Department of Revenue and Taxation, and the Bureau of Budget and Management Research are continuing their efforts to improve the format, content, and usefulness of this report. As reported recently, the DRT has about $161 million in accounts receivable for taxes. This includes $38.3 million for individual taxes, $38.3 million for corporate taxes, $23.7 million for withholding taxes, and $62.7 million for gross receipts and business privilege taxes, PPT. This amount of taxes owed by taxpayers has to be collected. Taxpayers have a responsibility to pay their tax assessment. If everyone was to pay what is owed to the government, we probably won't be in this financial situation that we are in right now. However, the reality is that in spite of being owed, the government still has to go out and find these non-compliant taxpayers in order to collect the funds that rightfully belong to this government. Collection of these receivables will surely impact our financials when received in the last quarter of this fiscal year. It should be noted that DRT collected about $6 million so far in this quarter from these receivables, and are estimating more will be collected in the next couple of months. We are moving in this effort to stay on track to reach the adopted appropriation level of $825.6 million and possibly beyond. The Bureau has provided support to DRT to assist them with their collection efforts. The Bureau cleared GG1s for tax auditors, GG1s for revenue agents needed for this effort, for aggressive audits. Consequently, these positions have been filled and are already at work. The Bureau will continue to work with DRT in this endeavor. They're going after the non-filers and those who are non-compliant, identifying taxpayers who are required to file tax returns and make appropriate assessments. Making sure that military contractors doing business in Guam are filing GRT and are in compliance. The Business License Compliance Task Force is doing physical inspections for licensing. They are aggressively going after large dollar cases. Revenue officers have been tasked to pursue aggressive collection on large accounts, $50,000 and above. These are some of the recent efforts the department has been doing in order to bring more revenue into this government. DRT have continued to aggressively collect or attempt to collect on the $161 million in receivables. This has been a painstaking and time-consuming process, and the staff is putting their best foot forward to address this issue. It is a matter of time before their efforts pay off, and we are hoping it happens soon. As we all know, our coffers need cash, lots of it, and he needs it right away. I've had discussions with the DOA director regarding efforts to improve the numbers, whether it be for auditing of accounts, analysis, posting, or reconciliations, etc. There are thousands of accounts of transactions under DOA's control, so we know more personnel have to be hired, and we're working on it. Based on the above mentioned and the assumption that the account receivables will be collected over the last quarter, the revenue should meet or exceed the FY 2016 adopted level. Jesus Masi.
Thank you very much for that statement. And how much of that $160 million that in receivables is for this current fiscal year?
I don't have the specific breakdown, but that's the amount that's on the table, and that's the amount they're working on drawing down or collecting on.
Even if they collected the 160 and added it on to, do you have your CRER for this month, this last one?
The June one?
Yeah,
I should have.
Give the senators the rest of them. They should come prepared too. Okay. All right.
Yeah, I have it, sir.
Even if all 160 million was collected between now and September the 30th, how much closer would you be to the 825 with current collections?
If all the 160 million in receivables were collected between now and September 30th,
yeah,
it would be a situation we would love.
I understand.
Because it would be
I'm
over and above the 125.5 million, and you can probably shoot 160 million more.
I understand. And your current collection is 609, right?
Those receivables, the 160 million dollars of receivables. I'm sorry, that might have been a hint tonight. Testing. Vice Speaker, we don't need to collect the whole $160,000 to reach the adopted $160 million to reach the adopted level, because already in our tracking and our anticipated receipts, we are expecting so much already from that pool of resources. The receivables are going to supplement that amount as we roll into the next couple months. So yes, if we collect significant amounts from the 160 million, it's going to add on to what we're already tracking.
But
so it should meet the level as it is showing now, because right now in the June CRER, our tracking, the bottom line is, although not much, 0.08%, it's still $654,572 more than the adopted level. So that's our tracking of the revenues.
You're tracking to get to the 825 includes collection of accounts receivables?
That's a tricky question, but it may include some of the anticipated receipts, but my understanding is this 160 million is a separate pool that they are working on to bring additional revenues in.
Okay, currently, so the listening audience can follow us. What is the actual collection for the end of the third quarter?
$609.8 million.
609.
Yes.
And what is the difference between the 609 and the anticipated revenue, the revenue projection for the year that you figure you're going to make, the 825?
$216 million. But already
and
in our
so
tracking?
So in the next 3 months, you're going to collect 216?
That's what we're looking at, and that's how we're tracking thus far, is that we're going to hit that mark.
And what formulas and what tracking are you using? I've asked this question since last year, and I think Senator Mike did too. What are you looking at? Tell us what you looked at.
We're looking
at how you got to the 825 from the 606 that we're currently at.
Because there are anticipated receipts and revenue that happens during the course of the year as people pay.
And I'm asking you.
Yes, so those...
With
those
all your analysts there, somebody chime in and tell me exactly what is it that you guys look at that makes you think that you're going to get to the 625. And this is a formula that you've been using every year or process you guys have been using annually for the last how many years?
With respect to the tracking, Senator, first of all, we still have two more months. So you have to consider that we still still have two more months of track of for actual. Secondly, you're looking at for the month of September. There's a lot of reconciliations that's going to take place. If you look at 15, there was a spike in on the collections for September. So, in terms of whether we're not going to meet or not, I think we're going to meet it based on our tracking. And two, we still have 2 months. And three, we're talking about a timing effect here. We're talking about people doing the invoicing, the collection, and the reconciliation and posting of these revenues.
And I'm asking, what exactly are you looking at that's going to give you $216 million in the next 90 days? Someone.
We're looking at revenue and tax, information that's provided to us, DOA, and they're posting. In terms of revenues, Senator, the revenues are collaborative effort with DOR, DOA, and BBMR. We take the information from DRT, we look at the posting at DOA banks, and that's for the reason, and it's for this reason that we usually wait until the audit is done to look at the final numbers for the revenues. And
well, thank you, because that was my problem. You have a copy of 2015's CRER. It's given to you. It should be marked on the top, June 2015 CRER. It's probably on the back page or something. It's on the back side.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We try to conserve. That's the 2015 one, right? Correct?
Yes. Third quarter 2015.
And at the same time last year, when we were down $817,000, you projected that we were going to get to the anticipated projection for the year, right? Both years you figured that we would somehow be over by 600,000. Is that a formula that you guys somehow use every year, that somehow every year we should end up at a little over 600,000? Your tracking somehow comes out to 600,000 over projection.
Senator, with respect to projections, it's our best guesstimate. It's our best estimate. We hope for the best. And if I was able to project the exactness that this body wants, I wouldn't be at BBMR. I'd be at Wall Street.
I understand.
So if you're asking us to be to the point on the projection, we're doing our best in terms of estimating what.
And that's why I keep asking you, what formulas are you using? There has to be something, you know, because for me, I came from the era before the calculators and everything else, and I would look and say, well, we currently have for income tax this number. We expect that it will increase X percent or X number of dollars per month. So it's plus this or whatever. What are you using to try to tell so that you can last year you anticipated getting to the projected revenue, right?
Well, yeah, well, the thing is when you, and my eyes are not as good as before, but In 2015, in June, it was 585.9 million that we collected, or we reported.
Yes.
You know,
and you
subject
to
auditing,
and
this year we got 609, right?
Yeah.
Yes, 609 million. 95, 2005. That's 25 million more. That's a positive. That's a positive.
Okay.
So
now,
if we're, because I wanted to just finish up your,
So what number do you show in your report?
No, it's the same thing that I'm trying to get to.
No, I'm talking about OFD's report or tracking. What are you showing?
Well, I'm asking you to tell me how you're trying to get to it, because
yeah, but I'm asking, I'm also asking Sandra.
This is not it, I'm trying to ask you, help me get what the number is going to be.
Senator, basically we have the same model. We look at the baseline first, and then we look at what we expect to receive from the market, the economic activities that occurred for FY 15 and 16. We go to GEDA, we go to labor, and we ask them, what do you think is going to happen?
And did you meet last year's projection? You did?
During our, well.
When you ended the year?
The CRER? Hold on, let me check that.
Well, according to Mr. Pangilinan, within September when we do all the reconciliations and everything.
But I didn't say we're going to meet. We're trying to meet, it was the best estimate. And if all the reconciliation is done and all the postings have been done and all the auditors shows are confirmed that revenues are there, then that's the revenues we receive. But we
and so did we make last year's anticipated revenue? Sorry. I'll help you.
They're checking it out.
You have a copy in front of you of the first page of the audit for this year, I mean for last year. You want to read the first paragraph, Mr. Cowell? Read the first paragraph into the record.
Can we get a couple more sets of these, please?
Read the first paragraph, Joey.
Yes, hold on, sir. Let me just get, can we just get a couple more copies? The government of Guam, general fund ended fiscal year 2015 with a $59.5 million deficit. This is $2.4 million less than the $61.9 million deficit in FY 2014 and brings the cumulative general fund deficit to $119.1 million. The FY 2015 deficit was mainly caused by $26.6 million shortfall in projected revenues.
Can we stop there? Read that again.
The FY 2015 deficit was mainly caused by $26.6 million shortfall in projected revenues.
And the projected revenue shortfalls, and then if you want, you can read the next sentence, but go to income taxes. It's in the next line down.
Next line down? Although.
Income taxes.
Sorry, Senator, my eyes are not focusing. You said just a couple of lines from that statement?
Income taxes were 11.7 underestimates and gross receipts were 20.7 below expectations. $20.7 million below. That's what I'm trying to get to. Last year we said we were going to get to our projected revenue. We didn't make it. Our best guesstimates didn't get us there. And part of our revenue, our deficit, is because of the fact
the 26.6 represents roughly 8% of the total general fund revenues. The fact is that at the end of the audit, and they did bring this the shortfall, we did the best for FY 2015 for our estimate. If we make it, then for as is, because our numbers were
high, you think?
Well, 8% is not as bad as it seems. We've tried to do our best for 2015.
And I'm trying to get us to try to, as close to as your governor used to like to say, bullseye. Remember when he used to make those claims when he had this chair?
Who's that?
Your governor.
Okay.
When he had this chair, he used to like to claim his projections were bullseye when it was 3% off, but it was still bullseye. And I'm trying to also emulate what he tried to do when he had this position. Try to get you all to help us, all of us together, come to a realistic realization of what the budget projection is going to be for next year. And I'm saying that if in 2015, when you were only off by less than a million, you were able to project a $1 million over the projection, but actually we're off by 20 million according to 26.6 according to the final numbers. This year, when you're admittedly already $16 million below by your own actuals, your actual collection and what you actually anticipated for it to be at the end of the third quarter. And you tell me you need to collect $216 million over the next, for July, August, and September. Where do you figure you're going to raise that money?
What was OFB's projection for last year? The reason why I'm asking, Vice Speaker, is important for us to, because it's easy to be a Monday night, quarterback.
We see it, but you won't, and you keep telling us that we won't. We're going to.
Yes, based on what we see, we're going to. Of course, you on the opposite side are going to say we don't see. But I'm saying we are anticipating and we're projecting. It's easy.
We'll just take just as BPT. All right.
What I'm saying is
you guys last year said we were going to make over $270 million in BPT. When I reduced it to 247, the governor hollered and screamed that I denied him $40 million in his budget.
And you did. And you did. Because he didn't request that. You cut it.
Yes, we did.
That's right. So you did deny him.
And you joined him in it. And you guys said, you're wrong, legislature and OFB. We're going to be so far ahead that by the end of the second quarter, we'll be making a request for a supplemental because we're going to get all this money.
Who said request for supplemental?
You asked the governor.
You asked me in a couple of oversight hearings when you were just trying to rip me up, and you mentioned about the supplemental. And I said, we're not going to my knowledge, we are not going to, the governor's not going to submit a supplemental. Okay. And you asked me to talk
but
to
but
him.
But the thing was it last July?
No, but the supplemental issue, Vice Speaker, is incorrect.
Well, I agree, because we didn't.
You agreed that you were incorrect. Thank
and
you.
I'm willing to, I just want you guys to realize your numbers are wrong.
What I'm saying.
When we reduced your BPT by $26 million, we should have reduced it 30-some. Are we going to make our BPT this year? Are we going to make BPT?
You're moving too fast in this discussion. I don't have quite the processing capacity as you have. So just a step back, please. It's, as I was saying about 10 minutes ago, or I was trying to say when you cut me off, it's easy to be a Monday night quarterback than when you're in the game. It's easy to say afterwards that you didn't collect than when you're trying to project based on whatever data you have or resources you have to then project what the number is. Did you project that to be forthcoming, that you were going to be $26 million short? You know what $26 million is in an $8 million pie? 1%, 2%?
It's enough to send us into a deficit.
It's 98% of collection rate, Vice Speaker. I think that's pretty good. If I had a 90% in my class, that would be an A. So yes, 26 is a hard number, and it is large.
When we add it to all the others, it becomes a cumulative loss.
But all I'm saying is that when we're projecting in June, and you're telling us the numbers in an audit almost a year later, those are two different scenarios, two different ones. So we are trying to project to the best of our ability with the data we have, with all the information that's given to us, and the information we gather, we project, we forecast.
And
this thing is saying it's a done deal. What is it now? It's a different play, is what I'm saying.
And do you expect that we're going to meet it?
And I said yes, and I keep saying yes. But you keep on, obviously, are of a different opinion. But you're asking me, and I'm saying yes. Based on all the information we have, that we know of, that's going to happen, it's yes. And we've been also indicating that these reports are subject to audit, just like the audit that happens. Analyses. We're not saying we are absolute. We are also saying there is a concern.
And I'm willing to admit that even I was wrong last year, all right? And you know why I was wrong?
No, I don't think you're ever wrong,
because
I never hear
it. Because in the BPT, I said that your estimates were aggressive. And so I reduced it. I made the mistake of accepting your percentage increase, because last year when we were projecting, I believe it was 249 last year, or 236 last year, we actually collected only 226. And what I should have done was use a 3% increase year over year. The budget that you guys presented last year figured this was going to be an 8% increase.
That's if all the assumptions that we had made and all the research and the data that we had compiled comes through, goes
and
through,
and
reaches fruition. That's the whole thing.
And we've had a banner year in tourism. Every year has been a banner month.
And we're having another one.
Yes.
Yes.
And I'm just saying, even with those banner months, our BPT collection is still not going to make this year's projection of 247.
And that's why
I made the mistake of accepting your projection of 8% increase when actually it should have been 3%. Or the 5% that you guys published in your prospectus that was issued on August the 5th of 2015, when you guys went to the market. I saw that prospectus. It said over the last 5 years, our gross receipts tax has gone up an average of 5%. So I'm willing to admit that I made a mistake by accepting your 8% increase. Just admit with me that we both made a mistake and we need to be more conservative this year so that we get closer.
our projections, Vice Speaker, are based on historical data. And then we go and find out what the various sectors of our community, or the industries that are out there. A lot of work is put into this process. And after doing all that, which requires a lot of time and effort and painstaking hours, countless of hours, many people involved in the process, we gather all of that, and we have assumptions, we have analyses. If all of that had reached maturity, so to speak, then yes, we're going to realize our projections. Unfortunately, those things didn't happen the way we saw it.
Part of the problem is that we used the wrong numbers to start with.
No, right? I cannot admit to that because it's based on.
Yeah, there was a year that we got 238. All right, but that year that we got 238 was the year that we had issued all the 200 or $300 million of tax refunds. Okay? And then the following year, we did 5% over the top on the top of that. That's the reason why that number was so high. But we should not have used the 238 because that was an anomaly for that year. When we realized that, even last year, rather than use the 5% over the 247, we should have used. We went back and said, no, we only collected 226 last year, so let's increase it by 8% over the 226 that was the actual that was going to be collected and was collected last year. So if we start using actuals rather than using the projected, we'd get a little closer. But if we take a year that's an anomaly because of the fact that we had $300 million worth of tax refunds issued Christmas, and we increased all the salaries of government employees, of course you're going to have a banner year in BPT. But we've got to start getting reasonable, and we've got to get realistic about what's happening around us. None of the revenue projections that we have from February have taken into account the fact that the construction industry is almost at a standstill.
Senator, if you're using the audited document here, and I'll read it. It says here the FY 2015 deficit was mainly caused by a $26 million shortfall in projected revenues, $24.4 million in unbudgeted expenditures, and $10.8 million in debt service that was not reimbursed by the Solid Waste Fund. Now, let's be fair. If you're going to say that we're short in revenues, and the audit says we are, it's also be fair to say that the deficit is not just a shortfall in the revenues. It's a shortfall in certain uncontrolled expenditures that we face every year. A good example is the $10.8 million on the solid waste. That contributes to the deficit.
And this year's budget, did you include the solid waste as part of the revenue for this year?
We conclude, and our revenue for this year is based on whatever they're able to generate for the year.
Did we make the same mistake and include in this year's, in the upcoming fiscal year's budget, the fact that we were expecting solid waste money and it was included as part of the
what revenue? We included in this year's...
Just say yes or no.
We included the revenues that were generated by solid waste as a part of the funding source.
But if
solid waste doesn't pay it, then...
And it's not going to... We're not going to collect it, are we?
But that money is legally owed by solid waste.
I understand.
Okay.
I understand.
So then we should go after solid waste. Now, let's be fair, Senator. If you're going to say we're short on revenues, and we also have to look at the other side of the coin. The coin is this is that we face unbudgeted expenditures every year. GWA.
And how can we have expenses that are unbudgeted?
Raising tax credits. We're trying to make things, we kind of work with what we have. And there's things that we have no control over. So.
But how could you guys have approved unbudgeted expenditures? I thought you guys have to show that there's authorization for an expenditure.
Yeah, I don't think we approved.
If it's unapproved, it's because it's required through debt service or through some legal authorization. It could be also a judicial court action. We have to follow the court cases if they require that we have to pay for something that we don't have funding for. There are also a lot of unmandated legislative bills that we have to take care of. So, yes, we do. There's unappropriated expenditures, and that's DOA that does it. But they have to do it because they're mandated to do it, or they... There's a debt service or a ceiling that they need to follow or they need to fulfill. So there's things that are beyond our control. So you're asking us if we can, or if we're going to control certain things. We like to control certain things, but there's certain things that we just can't control. We can only control what we can see in the revenues and the historic basis for those revenues. Now, please, Senator, if you're going to chastise for our forecast, let's also look at the expenditures that we have no control over. Go after solid waste. Maybe we can get the $10 million, okay?
We're on this side, okay?
And then bring them on the table and have them here as well. Why are they not paying us the $10 million that they owe us every year?
And I'm just saying, the executive has to do certain things. And I'm just saying, we need to start looking at what our revenue is. And if last year we included solid waste and it was not received, and we know that this year it's not going to be received, and it's not going to be received next year, then we have to accept the fact that it's not going to be or should not be included as part of the revenue for this year.
I
admit that it's going to be coming in, but it's being kept.
I think there's something in the mill, or there's some discussions on that matter, and it's ongoing. It's been a while, I think, but it's still happening. So at some point in time, we're hoping that would prove positive. But also, Senator, I'm kind of bothered with the fact that you say on your side, you really can't do anything.
Well,
you're very powerful. You know that, right? Just as you have said, and I think you're being facetious with me at BBMR, we say, oh, you are the most powerful position, you have the most powerful position in government, aside from the governor, BBMR.
I
and I think you're being facetious, or you're
I
real,
I
but
know.
If you were real, if you
I
were
real,
real, you
I
are the most
real.
Powerful person in this legislature, and you're telling me you can't do anything because you're on that side of the table? I said, come over to our side and help. Don't just be from your standpoint to chastise and criticize. You come and help.
And I'm trying to help us.
No, you just said you're on that side, so you're kind of washing your hands.
No, I am not washing my hands. I'm trying to
get it dirty.
I am trying to get us together to have a realistic revenue projection for next year.
I'm saying our revenue projections, Vice Speaker, and it's as realistic as we think it is based on a lot of analysis, a lot of discussions, a lot of interviews, fact-finding activities, and we're projecting out for something that may happen a year and a half later. That takes a lot. I don't think you appreciate the time and effort that staff and people in this government put into doing that kind of a model or doing that kind of project. And it's a projection. It's a projection. And if everything pans out, then we're going to hit it. And if it doesn't pan out, that's the consequence of it. But we can't just continue to pound a year later that we were wrong a year before. This is a moving target. Numbers happen. They change. They evolve. I've stated right before, the CRER that we submit on a monthly basis, we admit that these are subject to change. We have no control over that. When that dollar comes into the government, it filters out and it gets posted or whatever. It's all about auditing and posting and ensuring that the numbers are right. So we admit in our CRER that it's not absolute. It's not
perfect by our own admittance. I sign off on that, and every time I sign off, yeah, I bow in humility and say, we may be wrong. But those are the best numbers we can present, and it's a snapshot. Once we take a snapshot, Vice Speaker, numbers change. Things change.
All I'm trying to do is
saying is that the numbers, you don't appreciate the fact that these numbers, once they're inputted, it changes. Even as we are speaking now, action over a DRT, DOA, it's happening. Things are changing.
And
so we admit that it's going to be, at best, a draft. And I know you hate that word, but it's subject. Okay, I won't say draft then, but it's all imprinted on our analysis. It's subject to change. It's subject to change.
I understand, but I have to depend on it.
Not really. No, you don't have to depend on. You depend on us. That's very new, and I appreciate that. But I don't think you're serious about that.
I am.
No, I don't think so,
because
if you were serious about it, you would have been.
Because you guys are the ones that advise the governor, and he's the one that last year said on August the 25th, after we passed the budget, Calvo asked Cruz, this is the governor, to place an amendment in the bill that would replace the conservative projected revenues and the revenues of his initial executive budget, as long as monthly revenue trackings at the end of the second quarter of the fiscal year projects revenues to reach or exceed the governor's original revenue levels. The governor's amendment also called on giving him 100% spending and transfer authority and allotment release for all of the identified agencies with shortfalls.
And that's
that was
that's
last
a,
August.
That's a press release?
Yeah.
That was a press release?
Yes.
From the administration?
Yes.
Yeah, and then when you asked me in a couple of hearings about, did I hear or was I told about a supplemental, I said no. And by the way, I try not to read too much of the paper, because you always talk about my rosy glasses and other comments. You always do that, Vice Speaker.
But anyway,
you know that you have a responsibility for these projections as well?
Yes.
That's OFB?
And that's why I'm trying
to. So where are your numbers?
We have our numbers.
Where are your numbers?
Let's see it. We will issue it when we issue it.
Let's see it.
I'm trying to get you guys to do it, because what happens?
It should
now
be issued now, because what you keep pounding on is our projections. Where are yours? Because if you don't agree with ours, then you, as OFB chair, and you're the most powerful position, as you claim I am over here.
And that's the reason why I reduced your budget, your revenue.
Fantastic.
Last year.
So for FY17, you are responsible.
And I will.
By 2 GCA chapter 13 to project for the government.
And just be ready, because this year's budget revenue will not be down 40. It'll be down closer to 60.
And that's your, it's in your plate now. It's in your court.
You want to know why? Because S&P issued a ratings report on May of 2016. This is the GEFF bond, but it's the most recent one I can get. It quotes, management projections fiscal 2016 indicate reversals of recent trends, with estimates indicating $40 million general fund operating surplus, mainly as a result of strong revenue growth of 11%, expenditures growth of just 3%. Although the growth is positive, S&P Global Rating questions the soundness of such projections, when three consecutive fiscal years in which projected general fund surpluses or break-even results were instead moderate deficits.
And I'm glad you're stepping it up, because 2 GCA chapter 13 is all about you, OFB, doing the projections for the fiscal year, calling in the SES, calling in the SAS to compile the data to do the revenue forecast. All I'm saying, Senator, is the administration submitted its budget in January. In January. And it's been 6 months and we continue to play out this FY17 revenue debacle, dilemma. You as OFB chair are ultimately responsible for getting the revenue on track. So why do we have to dwell on what we proposed? You are to dispose of that. Administration proposes, you dispose.
And we did. And we
so tell us, so what is it?
And we reduced. We did reduce.
Okay, so that's what
and
I'm saying.
I'm glad my colleagues joined me in reducing it, okay?
No, that's what I'm saying. That's
and
good,
so,
because that's part
so
of the process.
Did.
It's
and
a process that that former Senator Ben Pangilinan had done as a chairman of Ways and Means. He did the process.
I'm trying to get you to help me convince them.
No.
That it's not just OFB.
No, it's the other way around. You should convince us then. If it's wrong, then present your numbers and get on with it. Get on with the program. Don't look back. Because OFB 2 GCA chapter 13 says you are the person that's going to take it. Administration has proposed its revenues. You dispose of it. But you keep coming back and trying to hammer us away when really it should already move to the next chapter, which
because
is you.
You keep insisting that it's going to make it.
Okay, then forget it.
It's not going to happen.
It's no longer in play.
Enough.
You play
thank
it
you.
Out
thank
because
you
that's your responsibility.
And we will.
That's good.
I
because
agree.
We have already done our responsibility, our part. We have submitted the packet. We've prepared the packet, and you have received it. That's what I'm saying as well.
Okay. Thank you.
And our projections are realistic based on our assumptions, based on our information gathering.
Yeah. And I'm just trying to ask you, is it realistic?
And I said yes. And you've asked me this in February, with the same agenda, and I said yes, because it's based on what we assumed, based on what we have on record. It's difficult to project. It's easier to sit back and say you're wrong.
But I'm not talking about the projection. I'm talking about the actuals for this year. Are we in trouble this year?
According to our tracking, it's still tracking to the adopted level.
But the actuals?
When we get there, it will be actuals. Right now, they're
but
not.
The actuals, as of June 30th, are we in trouble?
As of June 30th, we have $609.8 million in collections for the next 2 months or three reports, because it's going to include July. We are expecting to cover that to reach the level. From a projection standpoint, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So
thank you.
Joey, just in along those lines, saying that over the next 3 months, on average, you will collect about $70 million per month, in essence, right on average.
Well, in essence, because again, the receivables are, you know, the receivables are critical.
Right. So we're talking about
the receivables,
the
170,
the
161, the
161
that shows, like I read earlier, so much for.
Right, no,
the
and
tax
I understand
categories,
that.
Right? Yeah.
Right. The
yeah.
And I guess the follow-up question, which the chairman did ask, right, is does that 160 out of that $160 million, how much of it are receivables from this current fiscal year?
Right.
Because we know that in the past there's always been
cumulative,
a figure out there
cumulative.
That's like an $120
right.
million dollars
right.
that's been owed to the government that's never been collected. And so in my mind, we can't really use that $160 million figure as
not the total,
an assumption
yeah.
that it's going to come through.
Of course, not all.
Right.
Absolutely.
So,
yes.
I mean, you basically stated that I think there have been efforts made, and I think today or even the past month or two, you've been able to collect $6, $7, $8 million, something like that.
Right. Just from
that.
This receivable pool. Just
right,
from,
the total
receivable. Not from the regular payments of taxpayers and corporates and
right, these are the backs.
Those are like regular, normal, you know, it still happens.
Right.
These are stuff that's supposed to, you know, supplement or complement
right.
what we've been realizing
right.
over time. Yeah.
And
that's all we can base ourselves on, Senator.
No, and I appreciate that. But again, it's still, I guess, it's still a little problematic on our side until we fully understand And it's all future reading.
That's
at the best, at your best effort, right?
That's
taking into account all these different assumptions. I guess one of the points that the chairman made is, again, the assumption that we're going to collect that 10-point sum from solid waste. You know, and again, short of talking about how we're all going to get involved and try to help each other try to collect that, the question is it safe to assume that that 10.8 from solid waste is going to come in next year? And, you know, and if it's a 50-50, then, it, you know, type proposition, as opposed to we're 90% sure or 100% sure, a 50-50, I think, is more plausible to accept in terms of an assumption. Because when you start talking margins of errors, and I know that's what you really kind of try to fall within when you work with numbers, there's always that margin of error that you allow yourselves, right, which is a 3%, probably maybe up to 5% either way, right?
Right.
John, looks like you want to say something.
Yes.
What I'd like to say is that let's take solid waste to court. If they can't pay what they owe to Governor Guam, again, that's part of the revenues. That's the part of the revenue source that we've always used. Now, if we're not going to include it, then we're going to be in trouble with solid waste.
Well, right? No, we're just talking.
No, and you have to include solid waste as part of the revenue source because it's owed to Governor Guam. Okay? And if no one does anything about it, it's going to stay out there. Now, we've been asking solid waste to pay it, and they've been saying no. Now, if this body can help us get the money, then by all means, develop some legislation to force the issue. But
right.
Yeah, please bear in mind that the deficit is not just caused by our short revenues. It's also caused by people not helping us out by giving us what's due Governor Guam.
Right. But then again, in terms of trying to establish a budget for next year, you know, we can talk about all these policy calls and how we might be able to help each other along those lines. But when we just talk pure numbers and trying to set what it is, absent that, I understand it's a collectible, but is it going to be something that we could actually put into the bank, right, and say, okay, we can appropriate this money out for the operations of this government? If it's still a legal contention, right, that we need to go through, I think we all can, I think, John, we all can appreciate that even that would take a process to get through. So, again, I'm just trying to bring the tone down just a little bit, because I think really what we're trying to understand, right, is how do we move forward towards next year, right? Again, we know the assumptions are made. We don't know what the assumptions are, right, and what was thrown in to get to the figure that the administration has proposed. And until we understand what some of those assumptions are, again, we're only looking at numbers. That's all we're doing. And then on my side, and I'll be real frank, I'm quite a conservative when it comes to figures myself. I've always been, and I'm surprised that the chairman actually even said it, or at least implied it. I've always been of the mind that our budget for next year should always be based upon the actual collections from the previous year. You know, to me, and then if we go over, that's gravy. And then we get to pay down some other bills that might be hanging out there. That's always kind of been my position since I've been a senator. It may not be the smartest governmental type of approach, but it seems the more conservative approach that if we collected, let's call it $800 million last year, then we could probably safely say, barring any tragedy, that $800 million is a safe figure to use, and maybe we should work within that. Yeah, I'm just saying that's my position.
Yeah, that's being very conservative.
And that's being very conservative.
Your point is well taken. With
right.
our revenues, we normally, with the historical information, that probably takes up maybe like 80%, maybe 80%+ of our estimates,
right.
And the rest with the, you know, the other activities and the assumptions are all part of that.
Right.
But for the most part, you know, almost 80% of our projection is based on historical, tons of data analyzed, and that's the number that
right.
you know,
and
that's
and
a percentage.
That's what accounts for, I think, for that margin of error that everybody allows themselves when they're dealing with numbers and projections for the future, right? There's always a margin of error. Nothing's going to be exact. I mean, that's, if you hit it on the mark, I think that's just a stroke of luck, right?
And I appreciate that comment, Senator, because in the CRER, again, you know, if we do have that margin of error, and I'm hoping we didn't err in hitting that 825 adopted expected revenue level, you know, then we'll be okay. I hope the margin of error doesn't play against us here. I hope we collect it all.
Well, yeah. In that vein then, let me just ask you this, right? Within the last three quarters, you're saying we're going to hit it because we have 210 that's going to come in, or 200, whatever that figure is, 10 million is going to come in. Within that figure, is Section 30 factored in? Is that you're relying upon X amount in Section 30 to come in, and that'll account for a certain percentage of that 200 some million dollars? Or is that a totally separate?
No, that's really a separate bag in a sense. I mean, you know, Section 30, we always try to, there's always going to be reconciliations, and we're trying to maximize it and get all the numbers updated.
Right.
But at this point in time, we don't have anything to report out that is going to be above, you know, what is in the budget. We're hoping, because again, the reconciliation and all that discussion continues to happen even as we speak.
Right.
But right now, it's still the only thing we can say now. It's as we requested in the executive budget document.
Right.
$84.9 million.
Okay. Now, in your assumptions for 2016, going back, right? Again, it was said by the chairman that when we start taking a look at the construction industry, it's very flat right now. We know it. We know that, though, that there has been some money that has been appropriated, or, you know, through the national government, you know, and we probably will probably see some construction activity next year. Is that one of the assumptions that you've made in the past, at least for 2016? And then same question applies to 2017. Is that the same assumption?
My understanding is, from just looking at the data and the economic activities, is that the biggest thing that the problem that we have is the federal construction. Things have been really slowed down. But we still have our local government autonomous construction levels that will carry us forward. We still have tourism. And tourism, like the Senator Benjamin Cruz said, the chairman said that it is a bright spot every year. The building permits as of March, and that's the only number I have is as of March, surpassed 15. And that's mostly, I believe, local.
Right.
But we have 2 months of, we have 2 months of, which is August to September, and we have the next 6 months from October to March as a window where we're hoping to get more military contracts let out. And we're hoping that whatever problems they have, resolving because of some kind of procurement issues at the federal level, I hope that's resolved. But if you look at 14 and 15 construction levels, there were close to $300 million or over for each year, on top of our local. And we're hoping to see that in 17 as well. So we're hoping that that window, the 8 months window that we see, that's still available, would solve some of those problems. But as of right now, you know, that's 8 months away from here, and from now, and we're talking March, it's premature to say that we're not going to get the construction for the military.
It's an assumption that you've kind of made, right? As part of discussion in terms of your projections?
Yes, we were looking at the activities for the military as part of the increased economic activities.
Okay.
And why not? You know, we're part of this, we're in this, 16 through 20 time frame, where the military build is supposed to be accelerating.
Right.
And the only reason why it's not accelerating is because a federal procurement protest or issue. That's my understanding. At the federal level, and if they resolve that, and I'm hoping they resolve it, you know,
right.
Hopefully the money that the funding activities that we're seeing
right.
would take place.
And the point, John, is just basically that is one of the assumptions that we're including,
we
or at least that you're including, right?
You still have to include it because it's still there's a step the window of
there's
opportunity.
That good possibility
right.
that it could happen,
right? And
right. Well, let me just go to a different industry, John, because I understand.
Yeah.
I understand, and. But now we start talking about tourism, and again, the chairman did hit upon that. We're seeing record numbers, and yet we're not seeing a corresponding increase in perhaps GRTs or BPT, whatever it may be.
And that's where we're looking at the timing of posting and reconciliation.
Okay.
Remember, we're dealing with people here. People have to invoice. people have to post and people have to do the reconciliation. We're dealing with DOA and DRT. Okay, they have to post. Do they have sufficient people to update their posting? I don't know. But I do know that with all these activities, there should be some inkling or some kind of number that should be reflective in the GRT.
Well, I don't know how you do it from your office and work in terms of working some of the various. Hang on, John. Before you answer anything, I haven't asked the question. I know you're just chomping at the bit to say something, but I guess what I'm trying to lead down the road is we've kind of been made aware that from the very start of the fiscal year, right, in terms of tourism, we've been projecting really very. I mean, we've been tracking very well, right, and in fact. Since the start of the fiscal year, I've been saying, yeah, we're tracking for record numbers this year. And so because we started to see increases at the beginning of the fiscal year, I mean, you know, not just at the beginning, but I mean, starting the fiscal year, there were increases going on. And yet there doesn't seem to be a corresponding increase in the tax revenue that's coming in, even though they've been able to post because this was previous quarters, right? And it's still not tracking. And I guess the question becomes, in taking a look at that, I'll even call it an anomaly because it was probably unexpected, because you would expect that if with increased tourism, you'd see increase in tax collections because of the retail activity that may be going on or whatever it may be, right? But we're not seeing that. And so the question in my mind is whether in terms of the assumptions you're making for next year, in spite of the promise of increased tourism, that perhaps the tax revenues won't be as high as maybe we anticipated to be just based upon this year's tracking. And is that one of the assumptions that was at least discussed in terms of putting together the projections? And I don't know. I mean, I have to ask because I don't know, right?
But see, Senator, what you're looking at, you still have two more months of collections. You still have September for the reconciliation process. I was hoping that we'd get better numbers, but my feeling is, and it has to do with the timing of the posting of those collections, the postings of those revenues. And we don't have control over the people that are doing the work. And the other thing is, are people paying those required income tax and GRTs? Mm-hmm. It's all in an honor system. But if you have increased activities and tourism. Tourism is just one of the components, and it follows that there should be an increase in GRT.
So you think?
A good example is we also look at labor. If there was an increase in tourism, labor should be increased, but it's not. As of December, there was it was an increase in labor in December, but in March, I believe, it was sort of slowed. And we talk about that, and we found out that the people that are at Kmart, at the the beauty shops, probably doing more hours, working more hours than before and getting more income because the labor hasn't gone up yet, tourist activities have occurred. Now, if it's not tracking, then why is it not tracking? And it's there. So that means then that the reconciliation, the posting, the invoicing has to be done. And we believe that it should take place around September. I looked at September of 2015, and I believe the total revenues for that period was, what, $82 million? And if you compared it to the previous fiscal year, 14, it was like a $20 million difference. I'm just saying that's just one aspect that we're looking at, is that maybe there's a reconciliation process
right.
That needs to be done.
Yeah, and Senator, that I'm not sure if you were there when I made some comments. DRT is you know, has several programs that they are, you know, going after these types of, you know, non-compliant, non-filers. They even talk about the cash economy. So there's a lot of effort there because there is that recognition too that we should be getting more money than we are getting now. So they're putting their efforts into those types of activities.
So I trust that's one of the assumptions that you made when you came up, when you're putting together a budget projection, that because of all these extra efforts that we are undertaking as a government, whether it's revenue tax, whether it's whatever, then we should see a slight bump here, and that's what this goes on into the numbers as part of the projections.
Well, we're beefing up, you know, we're beefing up the effort, okay, to try to get DRT to bring in. I mean, there's just a lot of money and there's a lot of concerns that, you know, people are not paying but when they should, you know, right. Like just John alluded to, the honor system. So there are efforts to that endeavor, you know, to collect, to bring people in. And, you know, people are just, I don't know, they're just either avoiding to pay taxes or what. But we're putting up the effort. We're putting the effort to reach out and touch those guys, touch those people, and bring them in and have them pay what they should pay to the government.
You know, I have a few more questions, but I'm going to relinquish the mic right now. I think my colleagues might have a couple.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You stated earlier, Director, strengthening the agents at DRT. Do you know how many more bodies now compared to last year that I know Raymond Tax is out here, but I'm not sure from your understanding, you're saying you're beefing up the agents there,
right?
That from the previous year, looking at the challenges there of collections, that that, you know, I'm just trying to look what we're doing different this
right.
year.
Well, I don't have the comparative, you know, as far as the manpower, but I know that recently we've approved about seven personnel, seven GG1s, and they're on board and they're starting to work. So that's the kind of that's an example of you know, beefing up. And our discussions with Revenue Tax as well as DOA, because we talk about the timing issue, the posting, the auditing, all that. We're trying to give DOA some additional help there too. So that's what I'm talking about, you know, trying to give the support that's needed to recover the funds, or, you know, bring in the receivables, and also to make sure that the numbers are posted promptly, although that's almost a miracle in itself. But to get that particular aspect of the collection in place or improved, it's all about just improving what we've been doing. Yeah.
Is this the norm where most of the kind of the surge of revenue or collections comes in at the end of the tail end of the fiscal year?
I just ebbs and flows. So I you know, it just depends.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because I know you know, when you talked about snapshots, you know, again, yes, they change even right at the snapshots.
Yeah. No, what I'm saying is when we report numbers as of, let's say, June 30th, already, you know, the inflow of cash comes in, you know. I'm talking about that. I'm talking about the numbers are changing even as we speak.
I think I'm bringing this up from experience when I was at the COB and seeing that, you know, of course, at least with the construction or contracting industry, and again, most businesses are renewing around June 30 or within that month.
Right.
And of course, they go through a clearance process, and of course, that clearance process requires extensive review by all the clearing agencies, and one of them in particular is Revenue Tax. And of course, they have to at least clear with the renewal that they're in good standing with all these clearing agencies.
That's right.
So I'm just under the assumption that that's the reason why, maybe again, if that's why there's a surge within this period, July and September, because of these folks that are trying to come into good standing with the government so that they can obtain their renewals that they pay then. And if there's any, I know there's been proposals to see how that could be done at the forefront with the clearing agencies, but I know over the rules take place. Unless these agents or firms decide to renew earlier,
right.
And get out of way and start going through the clearance process. But again, I'm just under that assumption that that's the reason why maybe there's a surge, and of course getting a snapshot after the fiscal year is not a good way to indicate anything. And we don't normally look at third or fourth quarter because of those periods with many establishments that renew around this period.
Right.
Could that
and
be?
That seemed to be a good theory, because it come renewal time, it brings businesses whole. It brings them to, you know, own up to if they had not been current with their taxes, they pay. You know, there's other deficiencies, they deal with it at that particular point. So it could be that, that for months they were left unchecked, and now it's a day of reckoning, June 30th, when in order to get their license, they have to go through that whole process.
Right.
They have to just, you know, come clear with what they owe the government. And then as a result, maybe they're back in business full swing.
Right.
They could add more money to the coffer. So I think you have a good theory there.
Okay. Thank you, Director. Yeah. Appreciate it.
We'll stand in recess until